So I guess everybody here probably knows Jamal because, well, he's Jamal, so... I'll let him introduce what he's going to talk about. TC, in brief. Take it away.
All right, thanks.
So I think I just finished the slides while I was sitting there. So you'll have to forgive me. There was supposed to be a TC tutorial here, but Kong couldn't make it. So I stepped in, and my talk that was supposed to be on Monday, I'm sure I'll have my slides ready by then, got moved to today, yesterday. So last night I started on my slides, and I'm going to try to make it both what my talk was supposed to be and a little flavor maybe of a tutorial. So I'll talk very slowly because I have 2 hours. I thought I had 30 minutes before. So I'm mostly going to be talking about TC action. I'll describe the architecture, the use case, some of the use cases, some history, a little bit of history. Why am I doing it now? I'm finally, someone has to document this stuff at some point. So 10 years later or more probably, documentation is appearing now. So the paper that will be published will be probably the best documentation that exists. Other thing is, hopefully we can motivate people to build on top of this stuff as opposed to reinventing it. Can't stop people from reinventing things. It's open source. You can do whatever you want. But there's some good stuff here that I hope that will benefit when people understand how to use it, they could make better use of it. So that's the main motivation. And I was motivated because there's two talks in this conference, one of which I'm co-authoring, the other one by Yiri, that build on top of what TC does, TC actions. And since I have a lot of time, you can interrupt me anytime. And we can go on a tangent a little bit. All right, so life starts with a port. Packets, I was trying to be biblical there a little bit. Packets cometh, packets goeth. I don't know if those are real ones, but life of a packet starts when it comes in a port. Something happens in that network stack. Eventually, when success is defined, it goes out on an egress of a port. So we have a concept of an ingress port and an egress port. It may end up being the same port. In order to provide context, I'll touch briefly on the Linux data path. This is the Linux kernel data path. You have an ingress port. You have ingress traffic control. So if you're familiar with the ingress QDisk, that's where it sits. I'm generalizing this yellow box being either bridging or forward, any sort of forwarding, IPv4, V6. Prior to that, you have a net filter hook, which is known as pre-routing, or I don't know what they call it for EB tables, but something that happens before the forwarding function. If the packet is destined for the local host, then there's an input hook for net filter. Stuff happens in the stack. If you have to send it out, there's an output hook, which then is that pre-routing, I think? Someone correct me, I know the netfilter guys are here. After the forwarding is done, there's another hook. And then the packets go out on one of multiple ports. This is just showing instances of a netdev, which we call a netdev. If on the other hand, you're just doing packet forwarding, you could go to this hook, do your forwarding, go to another hook, and then get exercised through the egress traffic control, some scheduler, and then out you go. Or you could decide you totally want to bypass everything in the middle and do a packet redirect to an egress of a specific port of choice, depending on policy. Any questions of that? So the net filter hooks are located at strategic points in the data path. You add essentially callbacks where a matching filter results in that callback being invoked. So those are the strategic points where you can createNetFilter. I want to point out that everything you see here is can be written as modules. All those NetFilter hooks, callbacks, matches, or targets, any of these other pieces. So Linux is very modular in the sense that you can actually write simple pieces of code that you can then plug in into the system where the packet traverses. So the focus for this talk is this piece here, the traffic control on the ingress, the traffic control on the egress. We're going to ignore this other good stuff that exists. Any questions? All right, so on the ingress side, we have a dummy. So a packet comes in. We have this thing called an ingress QDisk, which is a hook into it's an anchor point for this box here. All it does is holds classifiers, which could be a bunch of different algorithms of classifiers and filters. When matched, some actions get executed. And I'll go into more details of this block. This is our focus. That same block exists on the egress as well. An outgoing packet gets exercised through a root QDisk, which then exercises the classifiers, actions, and these things could be hierarchical. So I could have this in pointing to another QDisk, which will then, I could have infinite, not infinite, but reasonable a number of hierarchies for classification and scheduling. I'm not going to go into the details of those things. Just know that it does exist, and it allows you to prescribe some interesting policies should you choose to do so. So our focus, again, is just this piece. Because if I've been warned I shouldn't stress people with a lot of TC. So I'm just going to stick to this piece here, which we'll call from now on the classify action block. It stands that we have to provide history since this is probably the only documentation that's known to exist for classifier action subsystem. Alexey Kuznetsov wrote the original code. Anything that's exemplary architecture that you see in TC is credited to Alexey. The code first appeared around 2.1 kernel time. Don't remember what year that was, but it was probably in the early 90s, maybe late 90s, I don't remember. But back then, Van Almosbagger did a lot of work back in the day, mostly educating people how this works and how it's used, how to add. He also did all the ATM work that ATM was the QoS flavor of the day back then. So he did a lot of the ATM scheduling, et cetera. Wrote some classifiers, QDisks, and partied hard in those days. I'm sure he's still partying hard. I created the A part of the CA. I am, in theory, still the maintainer. Dave M was patient in those days and tolerated some of the patches that showed up and provided a lot of words of wisdom. So those are the early days, but there's a lot of people that I see in this room. For example, Thomas contributed the basic classifier. If you want to do string processing with a classifier in TC, you can use the Boyer-Moore algorithm that he wrote. Patrick, I think I saw him somewhere here. He wrote a flow classifier. Steven Heminger, I don't know where he is, wrote the NetEM classifier. And recently there's some new generation of kids, like Daniel wrote the CLS, the BPF classifier. Yuri recently produced the OpenFlow classifier. I'm sorry if I forgot anybody. A drink was on me after if I forgot to mention it. But there's a lot of contribution going on. So, any questions? All right. Let's start with classifiers. This classify action block where you have this block called a classifier. It holds filters. By default, we always have one built-in filter. which matches on protocol. Anytime you specify a rule, you say proto 0x800 or you know, in text proto IP. Then you can follow that, you must specify that protocol, that built-in classifier, and then you follow with a set of filter rules. However, the design philosophy is we can have as many classifiers as there are flavors of ice cream. So whatever the day, flavor of the day is, someone thinks they have this greatest algorithm, eBPF, that today I think is, from what we saw, was an outstanding classification engine. Please, you know, we allow for that to be added as a classification engine. So the design principle here is there is no such thing as a universal classifier. There's no way in hell you can have a classifier that can match on everything efficiently. So that's an important design principle. So for example, I could classify, first of all, based on an eBPF, and then if I find what I'm looking for, I'll go and call an efficient string text search engine using either the Boyamore or I think Pablo had written the other one, the KMP algorithm. And each one of them has advantages or disadvantages. Depending on what I'm looking for, I'll use one or the other, right? Allows me the pleasure of doing that when I'm defining my policies. And I'll try and show some examples of how you do that. Now, there's several types, many classifiers. U32, which matches on a bunch of, it's almost like a TCAM match where you have an offset and a mask and a value. And you can build a series of these in a tree format to match the packets of interest. You have the route classifier, which is based on route attributes like realms. You have an RSVP classifier, was written back in the 90s, still around, which typically matches on the five tuples, source destination IP, protocol, TCP source destination ports. Basic classifier from Thomas, BPF from Daniel, Flow from Patrick, OpenFlow from Yuri. You go ahead and write another one. You can write one if you want. Each one of them has specific attributes that it's very good at. And that's the key. I'd like to emphasize that as a key principle, that you think you can, you know, if you want to classify based on some TLV, I think that's something I had recently, and you think you have this excellent algorithm that really is good at classifying on TLVs, then write a classifier, plug it in, use it in a mix and match with other classifiers that exist. So I'm just going to show an example for U32 classifier because Alexi say this was my favorite classifier. It is, but I'm not religious about it. It's essentially it's a bunch of hash tables. So this was written by Alexi. I'm not sure how many shots of vodka he had at the time. But he claimed it was very simple. It says it's called the simple U32 classifier, if you go and read the code. It's a bunch of hash tables with buckets, which are you can define the buckets. And each of these nodes that you see along the path here has actually got a 32-bit ID, which is addressable. So, so what do you do as a human being? You sit around and say, well, how do I write the most efficient way to match ICMP packets with specific range of IP addresses? Then you build your hash tables and you arrange them. So when a packet comes in two lookups, you can find probably a very complex header search than you would have using a classical simple. So you're basically defining your algorithm, how the lookup should happen when you write this thing. Right, so in this case, for example, I've defined a root hash table with 16 buckets, so that should be 15 actually. First thing I do is I match on protocol 800, which is IP. Then I based on what follows next, I select one of the buckets. In this case, I will look at 16. And then I'm going to match on ICMP. If it's not an ICMP, I'm going to go to the next one, which is TCP. If it matches TCP, I'm going to go down to another hash table. And on bucket number 6, which happens to be the TCP protocol number, I will then zone down into the different filter roles. And then I work a linked list. So every time there's a hash bucket, you either go through non-terminal filters, is what they're called, and further index into hash tables, or into a linked list where there's terminal filters which actually do the final match. And typically, the result of that match is an action, the beginning of an action chain, essentially. So allows you to basically create your own classification algorithm, as opposed to, I know how to do string search. It's more efficient if I do it in the following way. So this is why I like it, but most people don't use it the way I just described. Most people will just create, there's a default setup which will create just one hash bucket for you with a linked list. So you can actually use this and create a huge linked list. If you have a few rules, it's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you really want to optimize, and there's some people who actually have figured this out, and sometimes there's articles on the internet that are accurate that describe this. I've seen one or two that seem to know what they're doing. However, the important detail here is that each of these things has a node. Classifiers, while have a classification algorithm which defines them, have these key nodes, hashes, which are unique, are internal IDs, which is, if you look at these IDs, essentially when you define your rules, you're defining a routing, how to get to your terminal by inspecting headers. So that's, if you think of this as a routing node, that's node ID 0x100, 0x10, 0xx8. And then you, as you scroll down, you finally meet what you're looking for. I'll show an example. So whenever you dump a U32, the strange numbers you see there, which read 0x800, et cetera, those are key nodes. Those are addresses for these things, for these nodes that you see here. I'm just trying to point out this, that this could be very effective if you know what you're doing on having extremely efficient lookups, because it allows you to design your algorithm. I would not say that this is the most friendly way to do classification, but if you are desperate to have an efficient lookup and you know what you're doing, you should use this. If not, pick one of the other 10, right? Including, EBPF is, I was kind of impressed from what I saw. I haven't had time to dig deep into it. Any questions? Mike, please.
So did you say that the U32 can be masked?
Yeah, so each of these things here has a 32-bit, that's why it's called U32, it's 32-bit mask on a packet, and then you have a value that goes with it. So you have three fields. You specify the offset in the packet you're interested in, what to mask it with, and what value should be matched.
So when you're masking it, how can you do a hash lookup if there's different sized masks?
The masks are always 32-bit. Maybe I'm misunderstanding.
I'm assuming that the mask masks off part of the 32 bits and wildcards those bits. Is that not what the mask is?
Yeah, you could make them zeros and they become wildcards. And then when you, I think I'm misunderstanding what you're asking, but when you take the packet at an offset of some form, let me show you an example. I have time, so let me. Right. Actually, here you go. This one is easy because it matches on ICMP, right? So what it say, can anybody see this? I tried to make the font large. It's fine, or should I make it large? Bring it up? Fine, thanks. So this is basically saying that go, remember I showed the root set 800, and the other three fields are all zeros. Priorities of 10, I'll go into priorities later on. But we're saying here's the mask. Sorry, yeah, the mask at offset 8. Look at this mask. If the value is that, then I want you to accept the packet. That's the action, all right? So from that, I can construct a universal classifier, basically, of my choice, depending on the characteristics of the traffic that I'm looking for, right? So it's not optimized for a specific type of traffic. It's I can decide how it should look. Hey, Patrick is there, okay.
In the packet processor analogy, you've created a 32-bit matching field within an ACID or something like that. You just created a search criteria
yep. Of
32 bits from a specific offset.
Yes.
It happened to be what, offset 8?
In this case, yes. It's ICMP, so offset 8 at an IP packet is ICMP. It tells me the protocol type, therefore. I think that this is too hard for humans to understand, so this is where some sort of code generator would have been helpful to generate these parse trees, because this allows me to build a classifier that's very optimized for my test, basically. Or I have some very specialized traffic, I want to optimize only for that, as opposed to have a fixed classifier which is supposedly optimized for today's traffic. Somebody did research, collected some data on the network, and if my network is different, I could optimize it to do faster lookups. The point I'm trying to make here is your mileage may vary. Go and create a classifier that you think is more applicable to you. And there is no universal classifier. It's very hard. I think it's still science research to get the universal optimal classifier. I mean, otherwise people stop writing papers on classifiers. So that U32 thing was a digression. Great, I think I'm using my time optimally here. I should say this, that I can give a 2-hour tutorial on just U32. That's how complex it is. So one slide doesn't do it justice. I know somebody who attended one of those tutorials. And one of the feedback was, I think I need a brain surgery after this. So someone needs to write a tool that could probably generate these parse trees. And we have some, you know, you can use U32 and say match on source IP blah, and it's gonna go and generate, so there's it generates the code for you. However, when you read it back, you have to decode it as a human being. You saw that I had, for example, here, the way I generated this is by saying, there you go. This is what I sent to the kernel. Give me, please add this filter. Protocol is IP, priority is 10, match on IP protocol 1. Okay, well, I said 1. I could have said ICMP there, and the TC code knows how to generate for me offset 8. And call this flow ID number 1:10, and accept it. So all I'm doing here is I'm just counting these packets as they go through. As a matter of fact, let me show you another one of these, which is, I was just getting some help from Daniel about 5 minutes before I got up here. But here's how I would do the same rule using BPF, right? I'm sorry, that's just wrong. There. Right, so I just added a rule which says use the classifier called BPF using a generated bytecode file in this path, call it, give it flow ID 10. It just happens that this thing generates, it's something we generate in about 30 seconds there using TCP dump minus DDD and then a little bit of edit. And that file looks like, that's the bytecode for BPF. Just send this to the kernel. And now, this may be faster than U32, actually, for this simple case. Again, the point is, There's more than one ways to, I don't want to cut lovers, forgive me, to skin the cat. Right? And there's no universal way to do it. Right. Okay. Any questions on? All right. So this was sort of, there is a programmable way that you actually construct together classifiers and actions, which I'm going to proceed and describe here. So a packet comes into a classifier. Out of it come a packet plus possibly metadata, which then goes into this opaque block here, which I'm going to skip for now, that does actions or maybe even classifiers. Right? So between these two guys here, there's metadata and packets being exchanged. And what you can do is create a policy in user space, tell the kernel about it, which constitutes classifier action if you choose, or just classifier and a series of actions. What I'm going to show you is, in fact, embedded within that quote-unquote assembler is very strong programmatic constructs, statements, if, else conditions, while, go to's, continue, and end. So if I give you these constructs in any language, you can write me a program. And that has been there all along. It's just, it's not being very well utilized. So here's an example of programmatic control. So let me just deal with the classifier piece. So in the classifier piece, when I write rules, I arrange them in priority. Priority essentially is for the same protocol. When I say protocol IP, then the rules are arranged such that the lower valued priorities is actually more important than the higher valued priority. In fact, the rules could match exactly the same header, but in fact execute different things. And each of these rules, in fact, could be a different classification algorithm. So I could have a U32 followed by BPF, followed by the basic classifier, followed by a floor classifier, followed by an open, if it makes sense, right? If the policy dictates that that's how we have to specify things, I could specify them like that, right? So packets plus metadata come in, they go up here. This block may decide it wants to reclassify. So, for example, a simple use case for that is I have a tunnel header coming in, I strip the tunnel header, and I want to exercise the inner data through classification algorithm again. Or I push a tunnel header on there, I take it back, I want to exercise the outer header now through the classifier. Right, so that's where the use case for that is. The use case for this continue construct, so essentially if you look at this thing here, it's essentially a loop, right? It's a loop construct. And I can keep going back and forth, back and forth. Maybe, so if you submit a bad policy, it probably will hang your kernel. The other construct that applies to the classifier block is the continue construct. What that tells it is, I've given you, I know you called me with this rule, but I've decided I want you to continue to the next priority level. So it's going to continue on the next rule. So rule prior A, in this case, invoked the action block, did some things. You programmed it to say, well, you know, if you see this state, I just want you to continue. So you're essentially chaining. This is how you chain classifiers and actions together. Right? You can keep chaining them. I'll try and show examples of that. When the paper is published, it'll have more details. Does that make any sense? Does it not make any sense? I need some signal. Come on. It makes sense. Thanks. Thank you. So now, there's a few other constructs. So for a lack of a better name, in the paper I've actually used the term opcode to define what these things, what these are, what these values are. So an opcode of reclassify, an opcode of continue. There's a few other opcodes. One is called pass. I think that should have been called accept, but you know, that's what it's called, pass or okay. There's another one called stolen, when you steal a packet. And there's one called drop. And these are, while they affect what you'd call the pipeline of the policy, and some of them will, actually all of these three will terminate the pipeline, but with different end results. So when I have classifiers and actions, an action here based on some state, for example, you have a policer inside there and he says, okay, you've exceeded your rate. I'm not gonna let you go to Google, I'm gonna drop your packet. The policy may have dictated that, you know, may have described a chain of events that should occur on your packet. At that point, you don't get to go to the next level of the graph, of the policy graph, right? So I think I'll go into more details of this, but I mistakenly called it jump pack operation here, but in the paper it's called a loop operation. And the accept essentially allows the packet to proceed to the stack without further processing of the graph. So, for example, you may have a policy that says, if you match packets from Jamal going to Google, if he doesn't exceed 10 megabits per second, then the next action to exit, so police him to 10 megabits, if he doesn't exceed it, then you have a branch to, okay, well, look further into his packet and see what he's searching for example, using basic rule. And if searching for illicit material, then drop his packet else, continue. So if I say drop at any, I can terminate before I get to the second level at any point in that graph. I'll try and show some examples. Stolen means the action has actually stolen the packet from you. This may be for the reasons of, it may have queued it somewhere for later asynchronous reinjection. It may have decided to send it to a different machine, like when I redirect a packet to another port. It may have, for whatever reason, when you steal a packet from this pipeline, you just, you know, your code is that you tell the execution engine is, I have stolen this packet, do not continue processing. So nothing gets passed up the stack, the processing stops at that point, and the program control is returned to something else in the operating system. If I say drop, again, the packet doesn't get passed up, I just continue with the next item in the schedule. So those four quote-unquote opcodes affect the policy graph's pipeline. So as you can see, the way it's defined like this, it's feasible to implement this in hardware. Maybe it's feasible to implement it using eBPF, this whole engine. You should be able to write machine code that does this. Right, so here's an example of what I was just saying is a reclassify. I have a rule called A, it goes in there, and you know, this block says, I looked at this guy, I wanted to reclassify him again. And that means it goes to the next, it repeats that same rule again. It may not match, so it goes to the next one, which may invoke the associated actions, which may then decide that, well, I wanted to continue looking that, et cetera, right? So how you order these rules? Well, it's a control problem, it's up to the admin. However they arrange these rules decides the fate of the packet. All right, so we leave in the true Unix philosophy, mechanisms in the kernel, policies in user space. Or as the kids say these days, policy in the SDN control plane. Right. So here's an example. All right, so I'm saying Actually, this is a really bad example, but okay, let's just go with it. I want you to look at the firewall rule. This is a firewall classifier matches on SKB max, if you're familiar with what a mark is. It's a little tag that's relevant within the kernel that, so you just, as soon as the packet comes in, it may have come from somewhere where this tag has been set already, match on the mark number 3. If you find it, send it to this action, which may decide it wants to reclassify again. It may have changed the mark, which will then hit your next classifier rule, which uses the U32 algorithm, which I just showed earlier. And it looks for ICMP packets. If it finds the ICMP packets, something happens, which then says, OK, continue. This is where we now exercise the basic classifier and look for text called foo, the text string foo in the packet. And if that matches, we do something else. We probably eject at that point. This is not a good diagram, but we may have we may terminate the flow or the pipeline or whatever you want to call it at this point here. Or we could continue if we wanted to. All right, so it's a policy decision how you arrange these things. The kernel just does what you tell it to do. Any questions? Can you use the mic, Aviet? Sorry.
I speak loud.
I know, but those guys, can you hear him?
We can't record if you're speaking
mic. Just to verify, I understood. The yellow block means that it was ICMP with foo at some offset, right?
Yes. So, you know, you could inject foo into an ICMP packet if you wanted. I think what by default is it all zeros? Maybe, I don't know. Okay, so I just wanted to describe what classifiers look like and what programmatic controls you have over them. Next I'm going to describe actions, and I'll describe the programmatic controls around actions, then I'll try to put it together and summarize. Right, so again, actions, same Unix philosophy. Do something small, be good at it, a set of tools that can be combined to achieve an end goal. I have ls, pipe it into grep for foo, pipe it into cat, blah, pipe it into xags minus I. That same principle applies as well in this case. So little actions do something that they're good at. Typically, each action has its own attributes that are specific to itself. We have one special action which we call GACT or generic act, which its sole purpose for existence is to propagate what I call the opcodes. Right? So for example, if all I wanted to do was count packets, then I would use the GACT action to say okay. I'll just say action okay. And all I'm programming is an opcode to say if ICMP matches, then okay. And then when I dump the action okay, I get the statistics of how many times it's been hit and when was the last time it was hit, et cetera. So all I'm doing is counting packets. Or if I say action continue, then it continues to the next rule. Typical creation is from user space. You send each of these actions, in fact, has an index or an instance ID, which is 32-bit. So when I write into an action, I can actually specify what instance ID I wanted to be. If I don't specify that, then the kernel gives me whatever the next available one is. So I can specify action OK 3 times and not say anything, then I get 3 instances. And then I can associate that action with filters. And I may specify multiple filters that matching multiple different things using the same action instance. I don't know if I have an example of this, but I'll try to show one. Again, many, many little actions exist. There's one that's NAT, I think it was written by Herbert maybe, which is just stateless NAT. It takes a packet, looks at its source IP, looks up its little table, replaces the destination IP, and on the reverse direction, replaces either the source or destination depending on what you told it to. Right? There's one which is recomputes the checksum. You can tell it to recompute the checksum for IP, TCP. I don't remember what else it recomputes checksums for. There's one which uses the token, a dual token bucket filter. And that same one actually has moving window average estimate, EWMA, E-W-M-A policer built into it. It's a little cryptic on how to specify it. There should have been probably two different policers, but there's one that can do both a dual bucket as well as a moving window average. And of course, what I just described there is the generic action, which is capable of all, its sole reason for existence is just to program those opcodes to instruct the execution pipeline what to do. There's an arbitrary packet editor. I actually wrote that. I was crazy enough to copy what Alexei had done with the U32 classifier. But you can do interesting things with that. You can say, go to offset 8, I want to XOR the value with this, and then take the result and write it to offset 16. It doesn't expand, but you know, for fixed U32 values, you specify the operations. You can zero everything, you can set it to a specific value, you can XOR it, or you can OR it with a value. You can mirror packets as an action. So you say match this packet, it's an ICMP, mirror it to the other to port ETH0, or match it and mirror it to these four ports if you want. Or you can actually use the same action to redirect. And it's a very simple API that you can write code against. So you can actually go and write your own. I have a very simple one that's in the kernel that is used as an example. It's called simple. It takes a string that it prints every time it receives a packet. And it prints it on your syslog, it could be very noisy. But its sole purpose is to just express to you how to write one yourself. So you can take that one, do a VI mass edit, call it my action, and then the only piece you need to write is what attributes you want to receive from user space and what you want to happen in the data path when a packet enters this action. Any questions? Are people excited or are they just confused? Which one is it? Excited? Raise your hand if you're excited. Okay, 40%. Or I'm gonna excite, okay. Okay, Mike, please.
Why would I choose to do not through TC rather than using, for example, IP tables? Is it because of the where the action happens? So this happens before.
I know. I know. If you want to do like stateful NAT, they better not use IP tables. This one was, you know, historically they used. Alexei had NAT in the routing table. So, which is of course just packet processing stuff, right? You're a middle box, you route and you can NAT at the same time. So there's some complication in that. The code got moved. There are actually people using this. It's stateless, so it's a lot faster. And it's one-to-one mapping, so you can't do this. I don't think this does what people will call port address translation, where you have a single IP and multiple ports. It doesn't do that, but it's stateless. If you have one-to-one mapping, it's very fast. That's probably the only reason you want to use it. But I know some big organization that uses that for virtualization in a big, scalable way.
Right. So question about, are there existing actions that will effectively duplicate the packet? Number one, and number two, if I want to, what facilities do I have if I want to like effectively do a multicast delivery?
So I'll probably try to answer both. I would say a replicast as opposed to a multicast. I take the same packet and so let's say I wanted to send this packet. Let's say I don't want to change the packet, okay? I just want to, then the mirror would be fine, right? I'll just say this packet and I can have a policy which, with 1,000 mirrors, actions, so mirror here, mirror there, mirror there, mirror, and it will be mirrored to multiple ports or to the same port. I can, of course, build a graph where the MAC address gets changed before the mirror happens. Or I can build a graph where the IP address with NAT rule gets changed, then I mirror it to something. Or I can write on my own little, because I'm tired of having all these complex policies. They're human intensive. Unless I'm automating, I could go and write my own action that does all the above, right? The plugin is there. I don't know if, I think that probably. All right. So one thing to note here is that each action carries not just attributes to which it owns, but also there's a consistent API for, sorry, there's a consistent view of statistics. How many packets were seen? How many bytes were seen by this action? How many were dropped in terms of packet count and byte count? When was the last time this action was used? And when was it last installed? This is very consistent. And so, like I said, if you want just a simple packet counter, use the generic action, which says accept the packet, and you just keep count. Likewise, if you wanted to age, to have some algorithm that ages flows, create your flow. Somewhere in there, have an action that accepts and monitor the last use field and the time-wise, and then you can, you know, whatever your algorithm last recently used, delete the flows you don't want. There's another important attribute, which is very rarely used, but I'm going to show an example, actually. Where you can actually take an action instance and have multiple flows share that action instance. For example, let's say it's a policer for a group of people who may be coming from different ports. You create the policer instance 10, and then when you tie your flows to the different ports, you point them to this policer instance 10. And now, it's a little expensive if you're coming from multiple CPUs because you have to have a lock, a single lock. Each action is locked before it's used. Actually, it's only locked for a brief period where the stats are being updated, or something that's shared that's being updated, typically stats. So there may be some cache ping pongs. It's probably John Fasterbend recently added a RCU extension. So I think this lock may not be as bad as it used to be. But again, I want to emphasize this is only applicable if you're sharing the action, right? And I'm going to show an example of that. All right, so there's multiple ways you can create these graphs of actions, okay? So the simple one, which everybody's probably familiar with, is you create a pipe of them, right? This is the Unix way. You say A piped into B, piped into C, piped into D. Oh, actually, you know what? I was clever enough to have, I don't know if that's visible, but you see the Unix pipe operator? And in fact, the opcode for delivering this is called pipe. When you specify your actions and your policy, you say pipe. Some actions have a built-in default opcode, which is pipe. You can look at the code or install one and then do a dump, and it will show you that it's piping. Just like in a Unix pipe, in fact, I can go to the next action, and then this guy decides, well, this was an error. I don't want you to continue here, and it'll terminate right there. So that's why I kept using the time pipeline. Thomas, so what I mean by kill the pipeline. So if I'm going up here, and he says, this guy decides to drop, I don't proceed. I know it's a hardware term, but I was too busy to respond to your email back then. So any of these can be terminated early. So you don't have to go all the way there. If any of these actions, or action instances to be precise, is keeping state and it decides at any one point to say that, you know, I want you to drop, or I have accepted this. This guy is good. You don't need to exercise him through any other interrogation. Or I've stolen this packet. It's now off the record. I've taken it, right? Any of these guys, making such a decision will terminate this pipeline, right? So I basically subliminally introduce another opcode. It's called pipe. So far you've seen reclassify, you have seen continue, you have seen stolen, drop, and you've seen accept or okay or pass. It's the same thing. So next one is how do we do branch control within the actions, right? So there's something called repeat. Not very well exercised, but it's there, okay? So repeat means I could run an action and then I'll decide I want to repeat myself. So you have a loop construct within actions, right? So here I build a graph of actions where I say, okay, that's a policer probably. He didn't exceed his limit, go there. Pipe it to this guy. Sorry, I should go this path. Pipe to him. This guy does something, then based on his state, he decides, you know what, I want to repeat this again. Maybe I need to run this 10 times. Maybe you could write an action to do mirror to 10 ports. Right, so I've mirrored to one guy, I'm gonna mirror to the second guy, I'm gonna count until 10. Each time I'll increase the IF index or something like that. Right, so that's a loop construct. If I was to go back all the way here, where I showed the loop construct that is fed into the classifier, I'm showing you a loop construct inside here. Right, so I'm just introducing another opcode. It's called repeat. Hardly used, mostly because I guess nobody has published example scripts. You know how the internet works, right? Put one and then you go, no, that's not what I meant. Well, it's being used like that now. You have no choice. Right. Is it sinking in? I want this part to sink in. I don't want you to reinvent this stuff. You can use this. Hands up if you. Excellent. Thank you. All right. So I'm going to describe a simple program. So I just want to show, using the constructs I just showed, the conditionals, the branches, the loops, that I could, in fact, I could construct. And I was watching Alexi's output of the classical eBPF, BPF. It looked very similar. There's a fast phase where I'm looking at the protocol. In his case, he was showing the fetching of the offset where the protocol is. It's equivalent, right? I could say, and that's why I'm wondering now, could this be implemented actually with the eBPF? Is it 8.10Q? Yes. Then please pop the VLAN header. Reclassify. Remember reclassify? There. Reclassify. Go back again. Right? Is it now an IP? Is it carrying an IP header internally? Yes. OK. Is it 10.0.0.21.32? No. Is it that? Is it within that subnet? No. All right. I'm done. You accepted. I have nothing else to do for you. So essentially what I'm showing here is there's a loop construct. There's branches. Now, if I give you this construct, you can write a programming language. There is, in fact, a programming language. It's the TC BPF grammar. It's very precise, right? There is actually a BPF concise grammar if you use TC. And so, unfortunately, the BPF is probably not the most human-friendly way to express things to humans, right? So, when people say it's archaic, they probably are talking about the BPF grammar. But Alexi, who wrote that grammar, wrote a precise, formal way of describing the stuff, not in a human-friendly way or in a programmer-friendly way, right? But it's there. What we are asking is if there's somebody who can take that and maybe write some Python constructs around it. It will make TC more user-friendly. Right here, I just took that same, well, maybe not the same, actually. But I described it instead of into a flowchart, I described it into a functional view. Okay, so if I describe this in a functional view, remember when I said there was a built-in classifier? There is always a built-in classifier, which is, you know, what is the proto? If you list any TC rules, you'll see proto blah. And that's what I refer to as the, you can't get rid of that. Actually, we should probably have gotten rid of it, but it's built in. And then, you know, you, depending on what the proto is, you go to the next rules. And so essentially, there's a functional way to express it as well, not just a flow. Way of like a flow chart, right? I'm gonna mention that Werner Almersberger did try to write something called TCNG a while back, But it's not just about the classifier action. In that, at that time, classifier action was just showing up. The whole QDISC subsystem. How do you make that user-friendly? Some point, he abandoned that project. The code is still on the net. You can contact him. If you want to take it to the next level, you're more than welcome. I'm willing to probably do some testing for you and offer advice based on how much time I have. So to summarize, what I called opcodes. There are certain things that affect what the classifier does, and there are certain things that, if I was to build a pipeline of actions and classifiers, if the opcode continue means iterate to the next rule, the opcode reclassify, which is the loop construct, and anything else that gets returned from here will terminate the pipeline. Right, other than, so, and on the action side, a stolen queue gets returned here, ends what I meant by the CA pipeline. There's two things I'm trying to differentiate here. One is the CA, which means the whole two blocks. The other one is the action itself. So I can have what I describe as a pipe, right? A, pipe to B, pipe to C. That itself also has its own little controls. There's a question? Hold on. There's a question, and then there's another mic here. Yeah. There's one already ahead of you.
Why do you explicitly need to have an accept attribute? I mean, if you do nothing, it will just, you know, flow, right?
So if you're to look at this diagram, right? Typically, these things have conditionals, right? How to say this? This is a good packet. I don't want you to do anything, because when you return the code, you're telling the thing to do something on your behalf. It could either drop it, continue processing. You are giving it a signal, basically.
Okay. You could have said that if you say nothing, then it means accept it and move on.
Actually, if I go and look at the opcodes, it probably zero is accept.
So when you say steal it, it's like when people call it trapping. You want to trap. You don't want the packet to go to the original.
Yes. You basically, it's your, whoever says steal it owns that packet from now on.
And then they program something to do with this packet.
They may, you may sit it in a queue somewhere, and then 5 seconds later you re-inject it or something.
So steal it means don't throw it.
Don't.
And do what?
You stop any processing of that SKB from now on.
Can you mirror? There's a natural.
Yes, of course. Of course.
Okay.
For example, redirect. When you redirect, not mirror. When you redirect, you're stealing the packet. Yeah, you just say I've stolen this packet. I've sent it to another port. You will never see it again.
Can we build something stateful with it, meaning that you took a packet and you want to search for a condition on the next packet to come, or like to reconstruct a TC based on the previous TC?
So this is my personal belief that I think, for example, NF tables or NetFilter is excellent at stateful stuff. What we've been trying to strive for is, instead of us reinventing that stuff, we will consult NetFilter to do it for us. Now, on the other hand, you can do some simple things. For example, a policer is stateful because it keeps track of how much bandwidth your flow has used, right? But the state that's maintained there is very simple, right? It's how many tokens has this guy consumed? Depending on your policing algorithm, if there's, over a period of time, you're allowed certain more tokens trickle into the bucket, you're allowed to continue. So simple stateful stuff, yes. If it's packet stateful inspection, then we have an action called contract action. Well, it's called conmark. There's another one called IPT, which keeps breaking every time IP tables change, but recently, as of the last 2-3 years, it's stable. So you can actually invoke IP tables targets from as a TC action. I haven't tested in a while and nobody's complained, so I haven't had good reason to go and look. But you can actually invoke IP tables targets. And recently, an action from Felix, which has been running an OpenWRT for the last 4 or 5 years. I actually pushed that patch on his behalf to the kernel. It does con marking. It looks at the mark. So I'll show an example of con mark, because I have one. I have a good example of how stateful stuff could be kept track of. But we don't want to reinvent the wheel. This is the whole point. The reason I'm giving this talk is I don't want other people to reinvent things that we've already done. Please use them, extend them. That's the point, the whole point. I can't stop people in open source from putting stateful stuff in there, but if I have a say, you will not be allowed to replicate what IP tables is doing already.
Another question?
Yeah.
On the same picture?
This one?
Yes. When matching the IP addresses, you're showing sequential lookup, essentially, 10.0.21/32.
Yeah, in this case, for example, in that U32 thing I showed you earlier, I probably built a linked list in that case. But it depends on the classifier you use.
Right. More sophisticated, scalable data structure there.
Yes, you could actually write one that's very sophisticated that you could compress all of this stuff into like one rule if you wanted. Right? One TCAM rule, for example.
I'm thinking more like if I have 1,000 addresses to look for and take different actions, am I going through them sequentially, or can I put more complex data structure like a Redix tree?
So I'm saying that's your classification algorithm. You can write one yourself, right? And just use the plugin, put it in there, and it's going to use your algorithm. Yes, in this case, it's a linked list. To just answer your question, it's basically looking at the /32 prefix first, and then it looks at longest prefix /24. Right? So you're saying, is it 10? Is this this? No, is it part of the same subnet? It's a linked list. But it's not intended to show efficiency, rather it's showing features here, that you can do all those things. And it's showing the programmatic features. Okay. All right, actually, you know what? I will show you the example I was talking about, right here. So this is, so a while back, there was this thing called, and I'm showing this without using the IFB, by the way, because now contract is in the kernel, this con mark is in the kernel. You can do what's known as, in some areas of the world, there's one guy with a cable modem, and all his neighbors are sharing his cable modem. I have to say, I was you know, amused hearing about the use of, and they were using TC and IP tables combined together, right? So they created this thing called IMQ. I'm pretty sure Q at the end is queuing. Patrick would know this. Yeah. Patrick was involved in this. Okay, at least cleaning it up, etc. So I'm going to use that example and what we're doing today, and forget about IFB, which is the intermediate device. I'm going to just show it. This is what recently I tested the contract, the conmark thing. So let's say your packets are coming through one of the ports. You have a little OpenWRT device. In fact, I think, I could be mistaken. I think this is how the OpenWRT guys use conmark, right? So all your neighbors are, you know, all your friendly neighbors are connecting through your wireless. You give them DHCP addresses, right? So the three houses surrounding you, they get access through WLAN 0, and your home network is connected through ETH 0. Okay. So what you do is you have stateful classification happening at net filter. So as the neighbor's packets come in, you tag them with this thing called mark. You give them a tag. Mark one for all my, I'm just showing a simple example of one neighbor in this case, the blue neighbor. And your packets get a mark of one, of two. So as long as bandwidth is available, you and your neighbor will share. But when you want to watch your movie, you want to drop his packets. Right? So your packet, all the packets go out. Net filter, which is stateful, in this case, it keeps track whose flaws. So it's not just about keeping classifying based on the source IP, it's also classifying based on, it's what we'll, you would call deep packet inspection in this case. That's what Netfilter does. And it can keep a group of flows that belong to the neighbor and tag them with the same internal tag, which we call the mark. So the packets go out. If they're doing a big download, when they come back in, we consult with Netfilter in this case. Right, so in this case I used a U32 classifier, I could have used any classifier, and then I consult with ConMark, do you know this guy? And he says, yeah, his mark is 2. So I know it's the neighbor now, because it's keeping track of that customer, that neighbor. So once I look at that state, now I have a tag of 1, I now use the firewall classifier, which I showed you, Ali, which the only thing it does is it classifies based on the mark. And subsequent to that, I run everybody's traffic through this one policer that's shared. So I'm going to say, okay, everybody, including myself, gets access to this 256 kilobit chunk of bandwidth that I have. I have 1.256. And in my case, or in anybody else's case, in the neighbor's case, if it's exceeded, I pipe him to an action which drops and counts. So the cool thing about this is why whenever these guys were showing up and saying that they want to do shaping of TCP, I'm just saying, what happens when you actually police instead of shape? It means drop the packets, okay? The arc clocking is going to kick in, and the neighbor's packet flow is going to be downgraded. So there's two ways you can slow down TCP. One is you have the shape to a specific rate. The other one is you have a rough estimate. You say, okay, well, I will allow him to go up to 256 kilobits, and if he exceeds, I'm going to drop his, because he's downloading something. He's trying to download. So this is reverse policing, basically. He's downloading something. I'm going to wait for his data packets to come, and I'm going to start dropping them. Right? That will slow down. TCP will cut down his window, and you slow him down. Now, if you have a lot of bandwidth, no problem. You can use up all the 256 because you're busy visiting some friend somewhere. The one.
Is there a statistical drop?
Yes. Yeah. So, on the other hand, if it's my packets, I'm watching Netflix, I'm going to consume all the 256 meg if possible, 256k, and then I'm going to pass it to, see the branching there, right? Either I pass, it's showing the branching. Basically, if it's someone else's, it goes there. So, this is what I showed earlier as branch controls, if else conditions, if else, else, if. If else, if else, that's what's being illustrated here. So in that case, I have this 1 megabit, all right, I'm going to use all of it. So I am entitled to 1.25 megabits per second. Is it 1.25? Yeah, and my neighbor is entitled to share the 256 kilobits with me. And it's just the reverse effect. So in this case, we are actually using statefulness that exists within Netfilter or NF tables. And using stateless classification here. And it shows how you can mix and match and take the best of both worlds, or if you're a marketing guy, best of breed, of the different constructs that exist within the kernel. Right, so I was just experimenting with this recently, but typically what people will do is redirect the packet to IFB and then have it do shaping. Now that this piece is in the kernel, I can do this. Anybody got confused by that? Raise your hand if you got it. Thanks. Okay, so you can share your bandwidth with your neighbor now using TC. Okay, I sort of alluded to this earlier, that you can actually, let me show an example of this maybe. Yeah, this is just an example I was running earlier on. But you see that this policy was installed 18 seconds ago and last used 1 second ago. So if I'm installing 100,000 of these rules and I decide I don't have enough memory, I have to delete a few of them, and my algorithm is to look at the last recently used. I'm going to look at that field and age it out. I send a control to delete this thing. Right, so your algorithm may vary, but you have the sufficient information that you can age out rules. Late binding. I can actually install, remember I said every action instance has an ID, a 32-bit ID. I can install a bunch of actions of different types, and then later on I can create a filter which says use action with index 10. And I can create other filters to use the same actions. So that's what late binding stands for. This is recent. I was going to push the patch. I got too busy. But you can actually take a graph of actions and distribute them across machines. My use case is typically used mostly to scale machines. So I'll have one machine that then distributes across 10 processing machines, which distribute across 10 processing machines. Mostly because, so I'm doing horizontal scaling by taking a graph that existed before, splitting it into two or multiple, and putting horizontal extensions to the graph. So I'm going to submit that patch, but I haven't had it yet, had time yet. Yeah.
So about this scenario, this for me is the very interesting.
There's going to be a talk on this.
Okay. So just wait for the talk, or
No, you can ask. You can ask. We have plenty of time.
So I was just, curious how that worked for. I mean, the logic level, I understand, makes perfect sense. I mean, it's a pipeline, so you can split it.
Yes, yes.
I was just trying to get my hand around. Okay, so you're sitting in front of a CLI or some automated way to do it. You enter the policy. Do you need to go to each machine and enter the policy? Together, how does that work?
So, if you want to do it as a human being, you have to go to each machine.
Automated, I understand.
Yeah,
but
if you
it's not that you the TC mechanism, you're kind of communicating.
No, okay. I should have probably made it clear that TC uses Netlink, which is, and this API that I'm using has been around for a decade. It's very stable. You can write your own code to do whatever you want. You can write your code to create these policies, distribute them across machines. There's a small wire protocol that we're standardizing at ITF that not being observed by a lot of the big companies, thank God. So we have that, there's a wire protocol running between those.
So they can exchange information, I mean, not the control, but like the metadata, some metadata can travel
yes,
with the packet.
Exactly,
that is what
exactly.
Being standardized.
You got it, man. So
okay.
Come to the talk. Reserve your other questions for the talk.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
There is one basic assumption in all those cool tools that exist in the Linux that it's basically software and software can do everything. But let's take the morning's discussion. Mm-hmm. Can we describe a language? It's relevant for TCN to IP tables, EB tables, and all those cool stuff. Can we think of describing a language that will be able to query now capabilities of what are your capabilities within those level of degrees and try to restrict them and then offload them or accelerate them?
So you're almost leading into my future. But to answer your question, there's a lot of effort. John Fasterben is going to give a talk, maybe Monday, Tuesday, on one approach. My view is tools like NF tables or TC have existed. People have written books. Certification has been issued by some guy somewhere on how to use these tools. I'd like to see that tool set sitting. Sorry, go ahead.
if I might answer, I've been also looking into hardware offloading of IP tables features, different networking stack features for a long time. My opinion is that the hardware should not define what the user can do, basically what the hardware should do. The user should just use Linux as he always does, and if the hardware is capable of offloading that, then it should offload. But as soon as the user starts using a feature which it is not capable of offloading, it should automatically fall back to software. So basically, the hardware should not define what the Linux networking stack can do. This is my opinion. So actually, it's not that any of these tools need to change. It's basically the hardware needs to find out, is the currently used feature set which has been applied to this packet, can I offload this or can't I?
I tend to agree, but I think that there are two levels. So I think that the basic assumption that whatever can be offloaded should be offloaded is not always true. I think that sometimes you will want to have some kind of a TC or some kind of mechanism, filtering mechanism that should sit in the hardware. Another level that should sit in this, or some in the slow pass and some in the fast path. But I think that there should be some kind of a language, a metadata, that can be used between Linux and Linux applications to ask and to say, okay, these sets of rules I want to use in my super duper very flexible software because this is the slow path and the slow path does stuff not always the same way as the fast path, intentionally, not by mistake. I can give an example. At the hardware level, I might say, well, if it's a OSPF packet, send it no matter what to the CPU, and I would like to put different quality of service on hello packets that are sensitive for control or on update packets that are slightly less sensitive. So those are two levels that I'm not sure that even if I could, I would like to offload them directly to the hardware. So I'm looking for some kind of a negotiation to state, okay, I have my own set of TCs, they should not impact from the hardware what I should do in the users, in the software, but what is capable of offloading, some kind of a language to say, okay, if I have this ability to offload, let's offload.
I think, okay.
Can I add something? I think the language basically is the tooling we have. That's my opinion. Maybe the hardware offload buff we're going to have starting tomorrow. We'll discuss this mostly tomorrow, but I believe that, and I angled it as, there's a Linux certified engineer out there. Okay, we don't have one, but you know, if you're like Cisco certified engineer, that knows how to use these tools. You can just get rid of them. They already TC has a precise BNF grammar that some guy knows, and now you're going to tell him to go and learn a new tool or a new language.
No, I think his question was different. The question was if user space can find out the capabilities of the hardware to decide between alternatives. So user space can look at the hardware supports this and this is good enough for me, so I'm not going to do the usual thing I would do in software, but I'm going to compromise and take lesser feature set, but the one which I can offload. So user space would need simply a description of the capabilities of the hardware. This was his question, I think.
I think that's fair. Yeah. Actually, that sort of kind of leads into my next slide, which this is probably the functional discovery. When I first wrote this, I actually had some hooks in there to go and query the capabilities. I actually never implemented them, but they were there. There's actually some features. Kong Wang, about a year ago, submitted a patch and deleted them. I raised my hands, but David overruled me because there was no code in user space that actually took advantage of this capability discovery. And it was, to be honest with you, now that I'm looking at it, it was primitive. A lot of experience since then. My opinions on how to do capability discovery has changed immensely. I don't think you could have easily represented it by just a bit mask, like Netdev features. I don't think that is sufficient. So I think the time is ripe for having that kind of discussion. However, the tools for how to configure the hardware should be left to the user, and the current tools that exist. If I'm going to use TC or NF tables, you should let me. Or I use IP route 2 to add the route, don't introduce me to a new tool for this basic things like that. Complex things, new things, we can either extend the tools or introduce something new. So what's future work here? Of course, please, everybody, write one actionable classifier today. Usability, yeah, I think I know how to use it. But we need more people to we need to improve usability as it stands today, because and what I just what the hope I have from this is people will understand that it is in fact very programmable, and you can build interesting complex policies or policy graphs, and therefore you can extend that to a higher level language like Python or Lua or whatever your goal, whatever your flavor of the day is. There's some effort Werner started. I'm pretty sure you can download that code and proceed from there, or just throw it out and claim you invented everything yourself. It's also acceptable. Hardware offload, I think you've seen this slide. This is the little Realtek chip that Ben was working on, or has been working on. If I look at the current ways in which hardware is built, I can take that and map it into TC today. It's very simple, right? Here, this is a Realtek chip, which is quite interesting because I actually have, it runs on this thing. Managed to find some documentation somewhere because, you know, it's on the internet. Ben managed to reverse engineer a lot of things in this thing. And this is how it looks, okay? It has what I would call an ingress queue disk, because you can attach ACLs onto an, only on the ingress side. It has an FDB table, which is capable of VLANs. And it can, in fact, do VLAN filtering. The ingress queue disk has no way to do ACLs. It has four classes. So this is probably where the capability comes out. This thing can only do four queues. In software, I can do a million queues if I want. It's capable. It has two types of scheduling. It can do WFQ. It also is capable of doing strict priority with token bucket, or what it could probably be modeled as an HTB. These are all supported. It's your choice what you program into the hardware. So capability discovery is absolutely important. It has actions to drop, to mirror, to redirect, to police. There's a one weird action, which is to do priority adjustment. It could probably be modeled with SKB edit. And it has a table size of 32, which could be either looked as a property or a capability. All right, I was going to show some programs, but I don't know how much time we have. But I'll show just this. Huh? Oh, wow, OK. I could go on. People are still excited. I could go on. Anybody bored, tired, 5, 10 minutes, 15?
Was your brain surgeon again?
Yes. I'll show, because I was sitting there with Daniel, and he showed me how to quickly create a BPF filter. So I'm going to just show an example of a ping going to Google. First, I'll use, actually, I'm not going to show it. I'm just going to show you the script I ran. Okay. And then if you want me to continue, I can continue for the next few minutes. Actually, you know what? I'll quickly jump through the slides. So we can write, here's, I'm counting all packets coming from the, to a host. I'll ping Google. I installed a rule which says, if you see destination equal to Google on the egress, run the accept rule, and all the accept rule does is just count packets for me, and it allows the packet to proceed. I can now say, all right, ping Google and count packets on both the ingress and the egress. And you notice that I use two different accept instances. This is the sharing angle. I have now packets coming through. They all have the same index, 12. I'm using the same counter for both outgoing and incoming packets that match ping. Here's a more complex scenario where I first match on ICMP, and then I tag it with MAC 11. And then I run a police of 10 kilobits. If it's exceeded, I mark it with a tag of 12. So now it's going into the yellow zone. And then I run another police, an extra police of 20 kilobits. If it's exceeded, then I copy it to dummy zero, and I'm running TCP dump there, and I see all these packets that have exceeded 10 plus 20 kilobits. Otherwise, it goes on. I allow it to go through the to the internet. So that's a mirror action there. I said copy, but it's actually mirror. Here's another one where I'm actually just showing some interesting example where I share things between eth1 and loopback. Right. No good reason other than just to demonstrate features. Right. So you can see that the policer is index 2. You see that policer there? Instance 2 of the policer is shared on both directions. And as well, the policer of index 1 is also shared between packets coming through the loopback as well as those ones coming through eth1. This is where the locking may have been interesting. Okay, so let me show some examples, quick examples, and then maybe we can call it, you can take an early break. Okay, so I don't know which one this is, but I'm adding a simple priority to the egress side. I'm adding a TC scheduler, which does strict priority work conserving algorithm. And then I'm going to add a filter to it, which matches on ICMP, and I'm just going to count packets. Right? And then I'll repeat by changing the classifier rule from U32, and I'm going to use BPF. So I don't know how many packets I ping at this point. I think I pinged 10 times to Google. And then I'm going to run this command to dump the policy, right? And this is what you see. You can ignore these first few pieces. I was describing it as the hash nodes and all that. It's calling it a hash, but it's, you know, but here's the mask. And it shows me that, okay, it saw 980 bytes, counted 10 packets, was last used 1 second ago, and installed 18 seconds ago. I can also say I'm not interested in looking at the whole policy. I just want to see the action. Let's say in this case, index 1. And I can just dump this piece here of the policy. So I may have multiple of them. I just want to look at just one. Sometimes it's efficient. You can actually, if all you're interested in is in the statistics, you don't want to get everything and send it back to the controller. Just want to get just the stats, OK? That's all you're interested in. Somebody's exceeding their thing, you just want to start billing them a little bit more, right? So that's how you do it with the U32. If you're to do it with BPF as a classifier, then this is how you install it, right there. And then when you ping and you see an example output, it looks like that, right? So I sent 5 pings, I think, at this point, right? You can see that. It shows me the whole policy. This is the bytecode for BPF to match an ICMP packet. And in this case, 5 packets were sent, none were dropped, and 810 bytes were seen by this action. I probably had prepared quickly a few other examples. I don't know if they'll work or not. I may have tested them. This is the one with LO and if1. I tried to explain it in a programmatic way. If you were to write this as code, this is what it would look like. If the protocol is, remember the flow chart I showed? That's what this is. If it's ICMP, target with MAC 11, if the rate is less than 10 kilobits, right, we're done. Else, mark it with tag of 12. And if rate is still below 20 kilobits for the second policer, then we're done. Else, we're going to mirror this packet to dummy zero. And how do you install this using TC? This is how you install it. It's a little, as you can see, it's not for the weak out there, right? But you can see the actions. Now, what you're not seeing here is, so there, you see the controls there, pipe. If it doesn't exceed, then you pipe. Otherwise, you, and I'm pinging, and then I'm looking at results. There's your stats for each of the actions. And if you don't ping sufficiently to exceed your bandwidth, you'll see that some of the actions will never be hit. That's what I meant by pipeline terminating earlier. So So I could show you some more.
I think we all drank the Kool-Aid by now, and we're all going to write the TC action tonight. But can you show us some numbers? Like, you're seeing a lot of kilobit in there. So can you actually provide how fast is this going if you have a complicated list of actions, like the sample program you have? How fast
is Which one is this? The
well, any kind of
stats? So you want stats or?
No, just what if you pass?
Actual packet through this at a high rate. Have some complex
programming.
Oh, you're looking for performance numbers? Yeah, is that what you're asking?
Performance.
I don't have performance numbers. I've stopped doing performance numbers in 2004. That was the last time. It's very fast. Okay, if you want me to give you performance numbers, I'll give you performance numbers. How does that sound?
A little bit more because there's a lot of kilobit in there. It looks like you have a 56 kilobit more than performance.
Well, how do I show you that it's being dropped? With a simple ping. I'm restricting it to 22 kilobits because I know I can quickly show the drops going up, right? If I left it at 1 megabit, I have to start ping minus F, minus S, 6,000, then it starts dropping. But if you want performance numbers, anybody interested in performance numbers, talk to me. Right, there's a mic, is that Pablo?
No.
Okay. I will provide some numbers. What kind of performance are you interested in? It's extremely fast. This is does not maintain a lot of state. The control data path.
What is extremely fast? Are we talking gigabits, millions of packets per second? What is extremely fast?
Well, so in 2004, I was able to up. So let's put it this way. In 2004, I'm talking about 2004 when what is the P5 state of the art back then? I have slides. I presented some slides in Sukhon in Zurich in 2004 where I showed some numbers, right? That's the only time I was motivated to show numbers. And the numbers showed that, for example, I was comparing against Netfilter at the time, against IP tables, I think. How fast can I update what's the update per second I could achieve? Easily I could do 100,000 at the time per second of U32 rules. Packet processing, of course you're going to add latency if you have a little bit of, there is overhead when you add any extra code. But I would not expect it to be as high, let's say, as someone who's doing a lot of stateful. If you guys want to meet me at sunrise outside the hotel, bring your obvious t-shirt, let's go. Right? I'll make it worth your time.
So Jamal, the problem is that if we have a 10 gig NIC, right, we can do like 14 some odd million packets per second, right, with 64 byte frames. All of this stuff is under one lock in the Q disk, right? So
didn't you remove the lock?
I haven't removed it yet because you got to fix every Q disk to do it. You got to get lockless Q disks to work.
So are we talking about the egress side where
egress and ingress are both locked right
and
now?
And multiple flows or single flow?
Multiple flows because. That's what I care about.
Okay, so define your oranges first. The yellow, okay.
I think you'll take like a 50% hit. You'll drop down to like 6 million.
So how many CPUs do you have?
What's that?
How many CPUs?
Lots of CPUs, probably.
Look, we can always get better, right? But when you're comparing oranges, what are you comparing against to say that this is not good?
So, okay.
I will always take criticism which says, you can improve this. I accept that.
Okay.
But if you say, it sucks. It doesn't lock. Against what is the other better system that you have? Is there something that is faster than it? Then you'll get me going.
Okay.
I will now make sure that it's better than the other system you say is better, it's faster.
Okay.
Right? Well, that's the motivation I use.
Sure. Right. We're working on it to make it better.
Yes, I know. Look, what you're doing is improving performance, right? You got rid of the sharing of the ingress and egress lock. In introducing the RCU, remember that when I said actions can be shared, that's the use case where removing the bucket lock wins. Otherwise, most people don't even know that exists until now, I guess.
I think most people have, or at least a lot of the people I work with have multi-queue NICs, and that's where the case is.
So on the egress, yes, there is that queue disk is expensive. But when you can look at it two ways, because when I hear these comments, it's normally, are you comparing us to someone else and saying we're slower than them?
So my general benchmark is if I run without this, right, what performance can I get? And then I turn it on, and I notice that there's this performance drop. And
so you're saying if the hardware could do this, why do I have this lock in the data path of the software? That's a fair statement. The
hardware because we don't want to add a bunch of filters and then, you know, cut the performance in half.
No, I totally agree with you. Like, if this is what the hardware offload discussion is important, right? How do we bypass this?
This is not a hardware problem. This is a software problem. It has to do with the data structures and the logging. But I mean, we'll fix it.
Look, I trust your opinion, man. You've been looking at this for a while. Make it better.
Actually, I was particularly referring to actions. Like, what is the performance hit if you use actions? Like, if you pass it through a default queue disk, you get a performance X. Let's say I do some filtering on top of that with actions, with classifiers and actions.
Right.
Anything, like what is the performance? I'm just interested because the kind of use case are the same, the parsing and the action part is very similar for all the kinds of data path configuration tools we have. So we might as well share the data path eventually. So we need to know kind of what is the performance of each solution, what do we have, what is kind of a good general purpose, fast enough
This is fast. There is some locking in each action, and the locking is per, it's just in case the action is shared across. We lock for a small period of time, we update stats, we unlock, then other things proceed. So I would not consider actions as a, when you execute QD, you're gonna have some latency issues, right? There's no doubt about it. You added some extra code in the code path, it's needed. You're gonna suffer some penalty because you added extra code. More CPU cycles are being computed. Now, how expensive it is, I think that the only thing I can think of is that the action lock exists, and that lock is only meaningful when it's shared. Otherwise, it's always hitting one CPU all the time. If you have an action instance, Polisa Index 1, that is, as in this example here, I think it was that, I hope. See, that Polisa 1 is shared across multiple paths, so one CPU may be hitting this path, and the other CPU may be hitting that path, and they're both sharing Polisa Index 1. That will give you less performance than if that action was not shared. So from an action perspective, that's a challenge I see. QDisk perspective, I don't know how you do sharing without locking eventually, because you have multiple CPUs funneling towards an egress port. They're all sharing the same queue disk.
We have multiple queues. So we have a queue disk sitting above multiple queues. Each queue is bound to the core.
How much of, that's a good
thing. So you, instead of doing things like having global counters that then you need to start doing like tokenizing them. Like have a big bucket of tokens and then pull tokens from each queue, from each core, right?
Yeah,
and do it on some kind of sweep, kind of refresh rate. No, I mean, we can talk about this.
Yeah, yeah. No, I agree with you. Actually, that for that specific use.
The other case I think is you can have multiple. You can have shared actions, even if if you have two classifier chains, right? If you have one classifier chain and I have two cores, I can get to that same chain.
Yeah, that's the use case for actions. To respond to Thomas.
All I'm saying is you don't need two ingress ports. You could have a single ingress port and not the same issue.
If you have multiple queues,
yes.
Multiple entry points, yes. Yeah. So don't get me wrong. I accept criticism. The criticism that doesn't help is, oh, you suck. Okay, what are you doing about it? Go and fix it, damn it. Right. Sorry. Or if it's relative, then that makes me interested because you have a base case where I can actually compare against, say, okay, NF tables is faster, right? I'm now gonna compare, I have something to compare against. As a human being, you can always self-improve, and sometimes you have to compare against the status quo and you say, maybe I can do better, right? So I want that comparison, it helps. I know you've been doing a lot of good work on that, so I applaud your effort. And the use case you specified, yes, that is problematic because hardware is being built that way, and we need to move towards that direction. I don't have use cases of your scenario, so I'm a little biased from that perspective.
5 minutes left.
Anybody wants? Yeah, 5 minutes? Wow, okay. Wasn't a tutorial, but I think we were able to. I hope people understand. The whole point here was want people to understand this better, and I hope somehow achieve that goal. There'll be a paper as well printed. When you're going to bed, it's a good bedtime story for you. Bring a pencil with you to bed. Then you tag it on, send me email.
Having these graphs help, but could somebody please write a man page for PC Action and PC Classify?
You write one.
For the past 4 years, and
how about you write one?
I don't even know how to use it.
Okay, well, read the paper.
Oh, I pull the examples from large C and they're wrong.
Yeah, sometimes it's, you know, it's the internet. You can be anybody on the internet. Same thing, you can write whatever you want on the internet.
I kind of trust large C, even though it's how many years out of date. But
which one is this?
Large C.
Oh, that C, yes, the mailing list, yes.
But then the
right.
Examples are wrong, and the only thing you get is
they may be sometimes outdated, but they generally are in the right path. Talk to me, do you want to write a man page? You know where I live.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. You're more than welcome to write a man page. I'd like to encourage you. What do you want? You want me to buy you some lunch somewhere? We'll sit down? Okay. Because that kind of thing I find boring, to be honest with you. Even this documentation, it's 10 years late. At least. John, Thomas, I appreciate what you guys said. I'm sorry if I came out as being defensive there. We want to make this better. Any more questions? Yeah, mic over here.
The use case that you show with the mark.
This one or different?
I think this is the previous slide, where you have the netlink.
The sharing thing?
Netlink together, that filter together with.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you say mark, is that using the DSCP field?
No,
the,
it's
just an internal.
Yeah, it's an internal Linux tag.
It's in the SKB.
Yeah.
So it's not. Could you use an action on the TC so that you can populate the TC TSCP field for later?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you can. Typically, the DSCP, or I think it's still TOS, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, will be populated in the SKB prior, and you can use that as a classification index, for example, in some classifiers. Actually, I can't see the person talking. I don't know who's talking, so I can't see them. I'm just, oh, there you are. Okay, sorry. Yeah, you could use the SKB prior, which could be an 802.1p value, or it could be, as far as I remember, it could be the TOS value. But it may as well be the DSCP value. I could be wrong. I have to go and look. And if, do you know what it's? I don't remember. But it's one of the, either the first three bits or the last. Yeah. We're here for the next few days. Stop me, let's talk. I want people to use this, and I want people to build on top of it. And if you want to reinvent it, please go. Yeah, it's your choice. Yeah.
Hi.
Hi, Eric. Jamal,
I would like to make sure that people won't copy your stuff as is. Please don't flood google.com with your gigabytes per second. Thanks a lot.
did I show gigabytes per second? Is that what you're talking about, Thomas?
No.
Okay. No, yes, that's always a challenge. If you look at the examples on IP Route 2, let me show you an example that I wrote this and I thought.
Hang on, Jamal, I'm confused. I thought Google wanted all of us to be transiting through Google all the time.
Oh, I see what you mean, Eric, I'm sorry. But speaking of which, let me just show you guys something here. So, there's an example, okay. If you say I didn't write documentation, I actually did write documentation at some point, okay? I don't know, in the 90s when I was still naive. maybe it's before this. There's an example, I said, this is just an example, don't use it. And then I start seeing all kinds of Google pages with some guy using this example. Luckily, they didn't give credit to me. They took credit for this example, right? So, but I can't, I don't know which way, I'll find it. I thought it was here, but I can't find it now. But okay, I will not send the Google thing, I promise not to. I'll edit these slides before that. Right. All right. Okay, so. Okay.